Friends, in this class, we will discuss about another chapter in economics, that is the theory of consumer behavior. Friends, who are the consumer? At first, the question arises, who are the consumers? That means, who consumes something, they are the consumers. Who consumes? The person who has life, the being which who has life, that means the living being. The living being or the human being are known as the consumers. In this chapter, the theory of consumer behavior means how the consumers behaves towards consuming a certain commodity. They exhibit their likes, dislikes, opinions, their feelings, their emotions, their satisfaction by consuming a commodity. This is discussed in this chapter, the theory of consumer behavior. So at first we will go to the term utility. What is utility? This is the first term of consumer behavior. Utility. What do we mean by utility? Utility means the want satisfying power of a commodity. It means the want satisfying power of a commodity. The want satisfying power of a commodity is known as utility. What do you mean by the want satisfying power of a commodity? That means the amount of satisfaction that the consumers derive by consuming a certain commodity. This is known as the want satisfying power of a commodity. Friends, we know in our everyday life, we consume so many commodities. Why we consume those commodities? Because they satisfy our want. Because they satisfy our everyday want. Because they satisfy our need. That's why we consume this commodity. We cannot say that there is certain commodity which cannot satisfy our want. Even the sand of the ocean also satisfy human want. Air, light, sand, forest, jo bhi hai ye universe mein, every commodity you satisfy our wants. So we can say that as these have the want satisfying power, so we can say it has utility. Now friends, I can give you some examples. Suppose the example of bread. Bread. What type of want it satisfies? It satisfies our hunger. Satisfies our hunger. As bread satisfies our hunger, so we consume it. So it has utility. Bread has utility. Another example we can give, book. What type of desire it satisfies? It satisfies the desire for knowledge. The book satisfies our desire for knowledge. That's why it has utility for us. Another type of example, that means movie, TV or movie, TV. What type of utility it exhibits? What type of desire it satisfies? It satisfies our desire for government. I have given you here three examples. Bread, it satisfies our desire for hunger. Book, it satisfies our desire for knowledge. And TV, it satisfies our desire for entertainment. So, each and every commodity on this earth satisfies some desire. That's why we can say it has utility. Even I can say the example poison. पता है आप लोग को poison का मतलब क्या है? जहर जो होता है. Poison. It also satisfies some desire. How? We use it as pesticide. Pesticide for plants. So poison has utility. Also, it has another utility, very peculiar utility. That means the person who wants to kill himself, he uses this poison for suicide. So, every commodity has utility on the earth, on the world. So, this is the meaning of utility. That means the world satisfying power of a commodity. Each and every commodity on the earth satisfies some desire or satisfies some utility. That's why we say that utility exists in each and every commodity. So this is the meaning and definition of utility. Now we'll come to the characteristics of features of utility. What are the characteristic features of utility? Features. The features of utility. Number one, utility is subjective in nature. Utility is subjective in nature. This is the first feature of utility. What do you mean by this term? Utility is subjective in nature. First, I will tell you what is subjective. Who is a subject? I can say that who is not an object? Who is not an object? It is a subject. That means object and subject. What is the difference between an object and a subject? I can say object means non-living. That's why subject means living. So utility is subjective in nature means subject means here I can say the living being. The living being are here referred as subject. The living being, they exhibit their feelings, their emotions, their taste, their preferences, their satisfaction, dissatisfaction. All these are exhibited in the case of a living being. But in the case of non-living being, these things are not seen. So, only the subject, that means the living being, they can express their feelings, emotions, so they can express their satisfaction. So, utility is only the prerogative of the living being, not the non-living being. You know that living being, that means human being, they are the embodiment of living being, that means subject. Subject, they are the embodiment of a tangible body, tangible body with intangible intangible or intrinsic intrinsic qualities. This is subject, that means living being. How it is made up? They are the embodiment of a tangible body, a physical body with intangible qualities, that means feelings, emotions, likes, dislikes, hatredness, all these are the intangible qualities. Friends, I can say, on this earth, no two human beings are synonymous. No two human beings are identical in their nature. Though their physical body, it may be identical in nature, but their qualities are not identical in nature. The feelings, likes, dislikes of a particular human being, individual, is separate from the likes and dislikes of another individual. So utility is subjective in nature, means utility varies from person to person. Utility differs from individual to individual. My feelings and emotions and your feelings and emotions may not be same. My likes and dislikes and your likes and dislikes also it may not be same. So I can say that it is subjective in nature, means the it varies from person to person. Suppose I will give an example to you. Suppose there are two friends, A and B. A and B are two friends. A is a drunkard. A is a drunkard person and B is non-drunkard. In front of them, they have a glass of wine. There is a glass of wine in front of this two persons, A and B. They are two friends. What will be their impression? What will be their nature? What will be their preference by seeing this glass of wine? This, obviously, this drunkard person will be attracted towards the glass of wine very quickly. But in the case of a non-drunkard person, we will see the repulsion, just the opposite, the attraction, and in this case the repulsion. The person A, that means the drunkard, he will tell, "Oh, wow, kya aja hai, kya mast hai." Isse wo bolega, "Mera jeevan awad ho gaya. Now, by drinking this glass of milk, I will derive satisfaction just like the satisfaction in heaven. Heaven ka satisfaction mere ko milega." But this, you see, this non-drunkard person, his reaction is just opposite. He will say, "Mera isko khane se, isko peene se, mera jeevan barbaad ho jayega. I will be in hell, I will be damned." So this is two opposite feelings. So only the commodity is same. Commodity is a glass of wine. What we see here, the just the opposite reaction between the two friends. So I can say that utility varies from person to person because they are subject, they are human being. Their qualities are not same. Their feelings, emotions are not same. So this is the reaction towards the glass of wine. So now friends, now you are clear how utility is subjective in nature. Now we will go to the second point of features. utility is not measurable. Utility is not measurable. We cannot measure utility. Why? Because it is a subjective approach. It varies from person to person. One glass of wine, suppose it cost one glass of wine. For one glass of wine, the drunkard person is ready to pay rupees 500. Instead of he is ready to pay. But for the non-drunkard person, he has aversion towards this. So he will reject the glass of wine. That means negative. His feelings is negative. Here positive 500. Here his feelings is negative. He is not ready to pay any money. So in this case, how we will measure utility? Here the drunkard person, the satisfaction derived by the person A, that means the drunkard person, is this much, 500. But in this case, he is not ready to pay. The object is same, the glass of wine. So in this case, how we can measure utility? So utility cannot be measured because it is a subjective approach. The human sentiment, human feelings, you cannot measure. The depth of the human sentiment and feelings we cannot measure. This is just like the, as we cannot measure the depth of the ocean, just like we cannot measure the human mind. So utility cannot be measurable. But some economists, they say that utility can be measurable. According to some economists, utility can be measurable. नहीं तो economists में कैसे वो लोग theory बनाएंगे? So the cardinal economist like Marshall, Alfred Marshall, according to Marshall, utility can be measurable. How utility can be measurable? By converting it into monetary terms. That means for a particular object, the consumer is willing to pay how much amount of money. This is the utility of that object. That means the consumer is willing to pay or ready to pay the amount of money is the utility of that object. So we can convert utility into monetary term. In this way, utility can be measured. Converting utility into monetary terms. By converting the utility into monetary, suppose for one glass of coffee, I am ready to pay 10 rupees. So the utility or the satisfaction, the measurable utility derived from one glass of coffee is, one cup of coffee is rupees 10. In this way, we can measure utility by converting into money terms. This is known as cardinal group of economists. That means Marshall, who can say that utility can be measurable. But other groups of economists, they say that as utility is a subjective term, so it cannot be measurable at all. This school of economists are known as ordinal group of economists. They are Marshall, cardinal group, major ordinal group cannot measure. In this way, utility is measured. So, ordinal groups, we have to omit, we have to avoid them because they say that straightforward they have told utility cannot be measured. But we have to follow the cardinal group of economists, that is Marshallian group. the converting utility into money terms. In other way, utility also can be measured by not converting into money terms, by converting into unit. Converting into units. Suppose one mango, one apple, one unit of mango, one unit of apple. We have converted these objects into units. If we convert the object into unit and want to measure its utility or satisfaction, its unit is utils. U-T-I-L-S, its unit is utils. So this is the second feature of utility. That means utility is not measurable. Now we'll come to the third feature of utility. Utility is relative in nature. Utility is relative in nature. What is the meaning of this? Utility is relative in nature. Relative in nature means it relates to the consumer. That means the living being. Utility is not related to non-living being, because non-living being doesn't exhibit any feelings and emotions. Why? They do not consume also. A piece of stone, it is a non-living, it will not consume anything. And that's why it cannot exhibit any feelings or emotions. That's why utility is relative in nature means utility relates to the human being, living being, only the living being. Therefore, we say that utility is relative in nature. Living being, they exhibit their feelings and emotions, their satisfactions, their like and dislike. That's why they consume. They have the need for the commodity. That's why they consume. And this consumption depends on their intensity of the need. What do you mean by the intensity of their need? Now I'll give you an example. Suppose a thirsty person, non-thirsty, two person are there, one is thirsty person and the other is non-thirsty person. In front of them there is a glass of water, plain water. Whose intensity is more for the glass of milk? Who will stretch out his hand first to catch the glass of milk, whether the thirsty person or the non-thirsty person? Obviously, the thirsty person will go forward very quickly to take the glass of water. Sorry. So, utility is relative in nature means it depends upon the intensity of desire for the commodity. The desire for a glass of milk for a thirsty person is more acute than the non-thirsty person. So, in this sense, we can say utility is relative in nature. Now we will go to the next example. Utility is different from usefulness. Utility is different from usefulness. Friends, these two terms outwardly it looks like synonymous in nature. That means utility and usefulness. These two terms, outwardly they looks like similar. Its meaning is similar. But actually, these are not synonymous. This is not similar in nature. Utility and usefulness, their meaning, their sense is wide apart. Now I will tell you with the help of example. Suppose for example one, with the example I can explain you how these two terms are quite different. Suppose in the first example I will write a good may have utility, but it may not have usefulness. In the first case, I will explain you how utility and usefulness are different. The first case, the first example is, I have written here, a good may have utility. A good may have utility, but it may not have usefulness. How it is possible? How it is possible? We all see that the goods which has utility, it has also usefulness. But actually, in the real sense, it is not like this. The good may have utility, but it may not have usefulness. Suppose for example, wine. This is the example. Cigarette. Wine, cigarette. These are the examples. Wine and cigarette, they have utility. How? Because the definition of utility is the world satisfying power of a commodity. Whether it is good or bad, it is not matter. The commodity which satisfies human want, the consumer, by consuming a commodity, if they can satisfy themselves, we can say that the good has utility. So for a smoker, cigarette has utility because his desire is satisfied, so it has utility. For a drunkard, wine has utility because by drinking wine, he feels very happy, he feels very satisfied. So, for these two persons, a smoker, in the case of a smoker, and in the case of a drunkard, these two things has utility. Now we will see this, the usefulness. Whether we can say the wine and cigarette has usefulness for them? No, it is injurious for health. You see in the cigarette packet, cigarette is injurious for health. Tobacco can create cancer. So, this is the warning. So it has no usefulness, but they are consuming it because it satisfies their desire. As it satisfies their desire, so it has utility. But it doesn't have usefulness because it is injurious for them. So in this sense, we see utility is different from usefulness. That means the first example, a good may have utility. See here, wine and cigarette may have utility for the addicted person, but it may not have usefulness because it is injurious, harmful for them. So, utility and usefulness, they are not synonymous term. They are different, they are quite apart. Now I will give you another example. A good may have usefulness, but it may not have utility. This is just the opposite of the first example. In this case, I have written down, a good may have usefulness, commodity ka usefulness hai, but it may not have utility. How it happens? Now I will give you an example. This is a very peculiar, very interesting example. Example is your injection. Friends, you heard about this thing, injection. Now we will see how this commodity, this thing, this object satisfies our second example. May have usefulness. When we take injection, when we suffer from any disease, doctor tell us we have to take some medicine or we have to take some injection. Why? Because it cures our disease. As it cures our disease, so it has usefulness because it is beneficial for us at that moment. So it has usefulness, but it may not have utility. How it may not have utility? Utility means, friends, I have told you, utility means satisfaction. That means injection lene ko kisko acha lagta hai, man karta hai bhagne ke liye. Injection ka needle dekhne se hi man karta hai bhagne ke liye. So, why? Because it creates dissatisfaction in us. So, the commodity which creates dissatisfaction within the consumer, it may not have utility, but it has usefulness. Injection has usefulness, but it pains our body, so we think it dissatisfies us, so it has no utility at all. So now we see the two examples how utility is different from usefulness. Now you are very clear about this term, utility and usefulness. They are not at all synonymous in nature. Their meaning is different. Their useful term is also different. Friends, we will go to the next feature of utility. Devoid of any ethical or moral connotation, devoid of any ethical or moral connotation. So, as you connotation means subjective approach. From this sentence, we know that as it is a subjective approach, utility is a subjective approach. So, there is no ethical, no moral phenomenon. Because taking wine or taking cigarette, it is not a ethical or moral, in the ethical and moral point of view, it is not good. But the addicted person, yes, they derive satisfaction by consuming this commodity. So they consume this commodity. If you tell them, this is not ethical, this is not moral, this is not good for health, they will not listen to you because they don't follow any ethical or moral view. They only want to satisfy their desire. So this is the fifth feature of utility. That means utility is devoid of any ethical or moral connotation. Friends, these are the five features of utility. So friends, I have told you in this class about the fundamental things of utility. And in the next class, we will continue it further. Thank you.